you ever felt.
Are you listening? Damn.
Both been here too long. You can't go back to Ireland or Poland or England, and I can't go back to Africa. And we will live here together, or we'll die here together. And it's not I am telling you. Time is telling you. You will listen or you will perish.
You ever fail?
Are you listening?
Hey everybody, for those of you who have already seen my video, my meet and greet one, I wanted to say welcome back and to thank you so much for giving me a shot. And for those of you who are here for the first time, thank you for taking time out of your day to get to know me. I so fucking appreciate it. Oh, and I've got a foul mouth, just letting you know ahead of time. You get smiles with the fuck? I wanted to talk about well-intentioned racism. In my experience, this tends to come from people who have never actually encountered racism. And not encountering racism in itself is a privilege. But it leaves that person with a very warped view of how this world works. So unless they have a very deep sense of self-awareness or they choose to move outside of their privilege, they actually think that what they're saying to you is truly helpful advice. Now, what I'm about to share with you is something that happened to me, but I am totally certain that other minority groups have encountered a conversation very similar to this. It wasn't so much a conversation. Okay, anyway, a few years ago, I met a very nice older white lady and we started to talk about general things like, you know, the weather, my job, my kids. Now, this lady must have been feeling really fucking comfortable at this point because she threw out a statement from straight motherfucking left field. Like, honestly, I was not prepared for it. And at no point had we talked about race. But she must have been sitting on this statement for a very long time, just ruminating in her brain. And she was just waiting for an opportunity to say it to somebody who wasn't white. And this is what she said. I was raised to treat all people the same, regardless of their color. My belief in Jesus says that we're all the same. And by telling me that I have privilege when I have worked very hard for everything I have, creates a division between the races, which is not what Dr. Martin Luther King would have wanted. I have no control over what happens in your life or what you benefit from. As long as you work hard, you will do better. So let's just sit on that for a second. Okay, now like I said, I wasn't prepared for it. So I simply said nothing and I walked away. But if I had not been taken so off guard, this is what my response would have been. You know that thing you play in your head where you're like, this is what I would have said when you're sitting there taking a shower. Okay, anyway. One, I appreciate your stance, but do you even realize that the privilege you have in order for you to be able to say something like that with conviction? Two, this isn't about division. It was never about black people creating a divide because that divide has always been there. Three, it's about us black people being seen as equal human beings, not because someone has decided we should have it, but because it was always ours to have. The three-fifths clause was drafted during the Constitution, and those who decided on it agreed that black people were three-fifths of a white man, a human being. Our value, our humanity, our literal human worth was that shit wasn't forgotten. That was passed down from generation to generation. Even if the explicit language is forgotten, the emotion and the sentiment carries on in the DNA of anyone who still thinks it's a possibility. Four, the freedoms that you enjoy are because of your privilege. Our freedoms are because someone lets us have them only to the extent that they feel comfortable with it. 5, we are still relying on the generosity of a system that was literally created to break our bodies, our souls, and our wills. Until we are no longer of use, and then we are disposable like a piece of trash. And 6, so what you're saying is nice and it sounds plausible in a perfect world, which is where it sounds like you think we both live, but your world and my world are further apart than your rose-tinted glasses could ever see. 7, I am still fighting for the right to be seen as an actual human being with positives and negatives just like you, rather than the caricature that society has created in its mind between the light-skinned house slave and the dark-skinned field slave. That was your creation. So how about, rather than you telling me how to be more effective in my own skin, instead you sit down, observe the world around you from a black person's perspective, a perspective that has left many black people vulnerable and tentative, slightly weary from 400 years of hate forced upon them. That kind of perspective is what you need to sit in. Oh, and lastly, please stop using Dr. Martin Luther King as support for your kind of racism. The government saw him as a threat and not the nice sanitized black man that you keep shoving in our faces. In December of 1955, the FBI started monitoring him because of the Montgomery bus boycott. And they also routinely surveilled him. But more than that, let's not forget the famous suicide letter. This letter was supposed to have been written by one of his followers. It urged him to step down for the sake of the black community. It also alleged, among other things, adultery. Now the thing is, it was actually written by the FBI to create a division and force him to leave where he was in his position. This letter was eventually confirmed by who? The FBI. So the thing is, since I never got a chance to say those things to her, I'm saying it to every person who has ever told a minority how to be. Not just be wealthy or smarter or work harder or avoid being shot by the cops. What I mean is just be. How to be in their own skin and in their own community. How to simply fucking exist. At some point in this country, the well-intentioned racist needs to embrace the fact that they are not the gatekeepers of the black experience.
All we say to America is be true to what you said on paper. If I lived in China or even Russia or any totalitarian country, maybe I could understand some of these illegal injunctions. Maybe I could understand the denial of certain basic First Amendment privileges because they haven't committed themselves to that over there. But somewhere I read of the freedom of assembly. Somewhere I read of the freedom of speech. Somewhere I read of the freedom of press. Somewhere I read that the greatness of America is the right to protest far right. And so just as I say we aren't gonna let any dogs or water hoses turn us around, we aren't gonna let any injunction turn us around. Well, I don't know what will happen now. We've got some difficult days ahead. But it really doesn't matter with me now because I've been to the mountaintop. I don't mind. Like anybody, I would like to live a long life. Longevity has its place. But I'm not concerned about that now. I just want to do God's will. And He's allowed me to go up to the mountain. And I've looked over. And I've seen the promised land. I may not get there with you, but I want you to know tonight that we as a people will get to the promised land. So I'm happy tonight. I'm not worried about anything. I'm not fearing any man. Mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord.
So yeah, maybe that was a little heavy. So I want to thank everybody. I hope that this video left you with something to think or talk about. Until next time.